Good morning. Today we are going to talk about the paper that is going to be in the issue, July issue of Radiology, titled Diffusion Tensor Imaging of the Physis, a Possible Biomarker for Skeletal Growth, Experience with 151 Children. And I have the immense, the great pleasure to have the correspondent author with me today, Professor Diego Jaramillo from the Miami Children's Hospital. He is an associated chair and professor of radiology there. And so thank you, Diego, for being with us this morning. And my first question would be, can you explain what prompted you to conduct this study?
This study is actually the culmination of a number of years of work. Initially, we started working on animal models to look at the tensors in the physis, and it seemed promising. So we started taking some, because we were doing some diffusion studies on regular patients, so we would then do the diffusion tensor images and process them in the physis. And we noticed that you could actually look at the columnar architecture of the physis. And the good thing of this is that with conventional MRI, you see the physis as a series of layers. But functionally, the physis is really a series of columns. And that is what the diffusion tensor imaging information provides us with. So we thought that we could then start looking at children, and we noticed first that, and this was on a study published in Radiology in 2014, we noticed that the tensors were longer in the femur than in the tibia, and this is what we would have expected if they would reflect rate of growth, because femoral growth is greater than tibial growth. And then within the femur, the growth was greater in the periphery than in the center, which is what we would have expected as well. So that made us think that the modality could be used as a biomarker for growth. So then we took a cohort of patients that were having MRIs for other reasons. We excluded any patient who had pathology, and then we performed diffusion tensor imaging on this on these patients, and then recorded several parameters: age, gender, BMI, etc. And then we noticed that that there was a striking correlation between growth or expected velocity of growth and a number of the DTI parameters.
So this is actually amazing, because you started in 2014, it looks like, with animal model and all succession of this studies that you published. And can you just explain in more detail what the findings are, like briefly, and why they are important?
So the length, it has been shown histologically that rate of growth depends on the length of the columns of chondrocytes in the physis. And we noticed that the tensors not only extend into the physis, but also into the metaphysis in the newly formed bone. But still, the column of cartilage in newly formed bone corresponds to the rate of growth. And so when you start looking at DTI parameters, like the length of the tract, or particularly the volume of the tracts, they correlate well with the expected growth. So then we looked at the patients, and we noticed that in our population, the girls started having longer and longer tracts as they approached puberty. And so by age 11, they had a peak, and then the peak came down. Boys had the same findings, but 2 years later. These are the same findings that we see, for example, in the Tanner growth curve, where the longest, where the greatest speed of growth is in girls around 11 and in boys around 13. So, and then we looked at other parameters, for example, ADC. Interestingly, ADC does the same thing, but a couple years earlier. And then, but definitely, and then we also looked at short patients versus tall patients that were greater than the 50th percentile. And of course, the tall patients had longer, and this was particularly true in girls, the tall girls had longer tensors and larger tensor volumes than the short girls. So clearly, there seems to be, we haven't done a longitudinal study, but it seems to be related to speed of growth.
Okay, so yeah, you said it well. It looks like this is adding a layer to what the X-ray can inform us about bone growth. So what is then the real add value of your described method?
So the real added value is that you could have a biomarker for growth and have information about two things. How much growth there is going to be, and secondly, is the physis getting too close to physeal closure? So is there no more residual growth left? And the importance of this is, for example, with therapies like bone, growth hormone, where we administer growth hormone in patients, and it takes about a year or sometimes 2 years to determine whether there is response to therapy. Growth hormone costs approximately $50,000 per year. If you could identify the subset of patients that are responding to therapy after a few months, then you could decrease potential complications from therapy and also save a lot of money.
This is an absolutely great idea. I do think, as an application for growth problems is probably one of the most challenging, problem we have today. And having a biomarker like this one would be absolutely fantastic. So then it comes actually really to the next question, which is obviously if you have this idea about implementing in treatment in patients with growth problems, so do you think this method can be easily implemented everywhere, or you think the method as any others comes with some challenges? And if there are challenges, can you just tell us about them?
So we have used off-the-shelf products. So this is the diffusion-weighted sequence. We used all the imaging was done at 3 Tesla and Siemens 3 Tesla units, and using the conventional diffusion sequence that you can get on the magnet with 20 directions and B values of 0 and 600. So it's something that is readily obtainable really in any of the MRI units. Incidentally, we did obtain similar measurements at 1.5. So it's not exclusive to 3 Tesla imaging. You can get pretty good imaging at 1.5 as well. And also, and then it's the reconstruction is done with software called TrackViz. But you can use other software to reconstruct the tensors. And again, I mean, this is something that is readily available. The tricky part is in developing the expertise to sample the right area of the physis. But this is something that, I mean, several people in our team have become very proficient, and it's not immediately easy, but it's not terribly difficult either. I mean, it's not that more difficult than performing 3D reconstructions, for example.
Okay, so if I understand you well, you're using it in specific clinical situation at this point.
So right now we're conducting a study, an interesting study with survivors of neuroblastoma. And these are patients who have a lot of growth problems afterwards. Many of them require growth hormone administration. And interestingly, we've seen that for example, the fractional anisotropy is very different for the neuroblastoma patients than for the controls, and that the patients who have less growth have shorter tensors, a more disorganized growth plate, and and they don't have us as high NADC. So all of these parameters that come from the DTI seem to be correlating well with the rate of growth in the patients who are receiving growth hormone for and that are having growth problems in the case of neuroblastoma. The plan a little bit longer term is to follow a cohort of patients who are short and who have, some of which have growth hormone deficiency and some of which don't, and also to do a longitudinal study in normal patients, because one of the things that we don't have is longitudinal data. We don't have we have cross-sectional data from a lot of patients, but we haven't followed patients, let's say, for 2 or 3 years, and that's another thing that we plan to do.
Very interesting, and I'm looking forward to the next data longitudinally. I hope that you're going to just think about radiology to send it there. And
of course,
looking forward to it. I have my actually like I do think we are in the last question, and I really always, I mean I'm actually I've been doing some pediatric radiology in the past, MSK, and to me is actually the bone ages and legal issues is very important. So do you think we can use with confidence this method in resolving bone age legal issues, or simply your method just focuses on skeletal maturation?
I think at this point, we don't have enough data to have that degree of reliability. I think one thing that we can predict with a lot of certainty is whether there is growth potential or not. But beyond that, in terms of dating the growth plate or the skeleton, I don't think we're quite there. But it's one thing I was going to say is that another application going forward will be, for example, in patients who have chronic injuries to their growth plate. The thing that comes to mind, which is very common, is patients who have suffered chronic physeal injury due to sports, gymnasts, baseball players, etc. And again, these patients, it's very important to know, should they stop their activity, or and is there a damage to the growth plate, or can they continue exercising? And so again, that's another area where we would like to explore. But in all these cases, I don't think we have enough data yet to really know with certainty, for example, what is going to be the growth in the next few years, and how much and so the only thing we can say with certainty is there growth potential or not?
Thanks, Dr. Hamer. Thanks, Diego. It's been a pleasure talking to you, and thanks very much for joining from Switzerland. This is tremendous work, and it's very exciting, and I'm really looking forward to some longitudinal data that we're gonna receive hopefully in radiology. Thanks again.
Thank you.